Hey guys, this is The Blazing Show with Chris, and I'm here with Victor Ostrovsky. Victor, are you there?
I am indeed.
Oh, and welcome to the show, Victor.
Thank you.
No problem. Can you introduce yourself? Talk a little bit about yourself. Welcome to the show, by the way. You are former Mossad agent, right?
Police officer.
Oh, police officer?
No, former case officer.
Oh, former case officer. Oh. Well, please clarify that, because maybe I got some things wrong, so don't mind me.
An agent is the guy who is recruited by an intelligence service.
Oh. So when you were recruited, you actually worked there, right?
You're a case officer.
Oh, wow. Well, can you talk about your experience there? Like, what was it like? You said, because I asked before, you said it was like the CIA of the U.S.
It's Israel's CIA.
Oh, I think of more like if it's a, you're working like in a cubicle or something, like in an office. That's what I thought.
You go out people from the terrorist groups or whatever, and then you turn them and you make them work for you.
Oh. Wow, that's interesting. Wait, so you worked there for how long? Like, many years?
4 years. I was lieutenant commander in the Navy first, and then was recruited to the agency.
Oh, wow. Nice. What's your thoughts on basically the U.S. funding and supporting Israel? Like, I don't want to bash Israel or anything, but like, the U.S. and Israel are like tied. Like, they're like best friends, I think. Are they?
It's the only stable country in the region that is pro-American, so you'd expect that to happen. Israel and the U.S. are allies.
By the way, can you clarify what exactly, like, if the like, in case people have misconceptions about the Mossad, because people think that, oh, Israel, you know, they're terrorists this and terrorists that, but you work there, could you clarify what really is the Mossad, just the intelligence agency, because in case people have misconceptions,
it's called a foreign intelligence service, which means it's outside of Israel to gather information. That could support and provide for the security services. It identifies threats, and it tries to neutralize them.
One thing I had in mind when I was looking up, like researching 9/11, many people keep saying that Mossad was part of it, but like, can you clarify that?
Yeah, well, that is the most ridiculous statement I've heard. And I've heard it too, but it's absolutely ridiculous.
Why do you say that?
Mossad would never do that.
Ah.
It's a legitimate intelligence service. It's not a terrorist group.
Ah. Because I was researching this and. Even though the Mossad didn't do it, they probably knew intel about it and something about, like, they got out of the buildings, but, like, the U.S. government just stood down and let it happen. But
another piece of nonsense. Where did you research this on let's find
I forgot the...
You can find anything you want on the internet. I mean, if you go out on the internet and you say, I want to find, you know, that the... President of the United States is one thing or another, you'll find a website that'll tell you that. I mean, the internet is not...
Well, besides the internet, I would look on YouTube videos and documentaries, and they would talk about the Mossad, but I thought you could, like... Maybe that's another misconception I have. Maybe I'm wrong.
Talk about the Mossad. The documentaries that you're talking about are questionable. They haven't been vetted by a legitimate... base. They don't. Yeah. If somebody, let me explain to you. Let's say you have a guy coming online on YouTube and saying 1, 2, 3, 4, right? Well, you may believe him or not, unless you are a formal media base that needs to vet the guy and find out his background, where does he come from, verify the fact that he was or wasn't what he says he was, and then it's just a guy talking on YouTube.
Oh, well, I did.
Anybody can say anything they want on YouTube. I mean, you know that.
Yeah, definitely. What if it was, let's see, this. What about this video, MI5 agent? We're talking about British intelligence agency.
Moscow and Washington say they hope that the FBI arrests of alleged Russian agents.
Are you sure that the person that says he is MI5 is actually MI5?
Is the video's titled MI5 agent Annie Macken knows Israel Mossad was behind 9/11. And it was on Russia today.
So how do you know he was actually MI5? That's what the video says. I'll say I'm Putin's brother. And I know Putin is crazy. So what does that mean? And I changed my name because I didn't want to be related to him. I mean, so I say it. Well, what's the point? Give me some. I'll give you an example. There's a video that says that during the investigation, during the congressional hearings on the Iran-Contra affair, Al Gore asked Ali North a question, and Ali North said that the reason he spent all that money on the security for his house, which was $100,000, it was because he was threatened by Osama bin Laden. And Al Gore said, "Osama who?" And they kind of made fun of Al Gore. Well, if you go to the actual documentation, which is available online, of the congressional hearings that they publish, you'll see that A, Al Gore was not a member of the committee. B, that the name Osama bin Laden doesn't appear anywhere in the congressional hearings. It was actually another terrorist that he was talking about. But there's still a video telling that and talking about it. So what does that mean?
That
did you actually go to see if this guy who is claiming to be an MI5 guy was actually an MI5? And how would the MI5 even know what the Mossad is doing and not doing? Do you think the Mossad would call the MI5 and say, by the way, we're involved in this conspiracy, but don't tell anybody? Does it make any sense to you?
No.
I mean, if you were going to go rob a bank, would you call a friend of yours and say, by the way, I'm going to be robbing a bank tomorrow? You're not involved, but just so you know.
Oh, that would be stupid, actually.
Well, there you go. And you think Mossad is stupid?
No.
Then why would they think they would call an MI5 guy and tell him what's happening?
Because there's so many documentaries. I'm not trying to insult you or anything. There's so many documentaries here. There's one that's 46 minutes. Was it 46 minutes?
A documentary. The real thing that is called a documentary is actually a film that is created by a producer that actually has documents to back up what he says. And he vets those documents, and you get it. That's why you don't see those documentaries on a legitimate network or even a cable network.
Oh.
Because they vet it. And they say, that's nonsense. We can't put it up. But YouTube will take anything. I mean, you have cats dancing. And you have dogs that lick their owners. And, that's where the YouTube should stay. You cannot tell me about documentaries that come up on YouTube and use that as a basis for any kind of intelligent conversation.
Oh.
It's nonsense, and you definitely can't call that I did research.
It's not just me, but in case anybody who's listening.
I'm
so
sure a lot of people believe in conspiracy. If governments were capable of doing conspiracies that actually could hold water, governments are not equipped to do that. They're they can barely hold their own on doing things that are legitimate.
Okay. When it comes, would the Mossad have anything to do with ISIL in your perspective?
I'm sure they're researching it, and I'm sure they're trying to recruit people, and I'm sure they're trying to send people into ISIL that could bring out information and tell, you know, and provide that information both to the U.S. if they think deem necessary, or for actions on their own. Don't forget, this is happening on Israel's border. You know, Israel doesn't want to have, you know, ISIL controlling Syria right on their border. That's not a neighbor you want.
Oh.
So I'm sure they're taking every action that they can to either provide information to the allies that are fighting ISIL or fight them themselves.
I've noticed ISIL and ISIS, aren't they the same thing, pretty much?
It's a different kind of calling it. It's the Islamic State, which is basically what they call ISIL, or ISIS is how they call themselves. But it's the same, one and the same.
And some dude named Abu Bakr. Excuse me?
One guy calls somebody Robert, and the other guy calls him Bob. Same guy.
There's this dude, Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi, also known as the Caliph, the head of Israel. According to Edward Snowden, he's an actor named Elliot Shemon, a Mossad-trained operative. Or what's your perspective on that statement?
No. Actually, that's not true. I've looked at a lot of the documents by Snowden. There is no such legitimate document by Snowden that was actually put out by the organization that released his information. So that's not correct. He never released the document stating that. And if you check your document again, you'll see that it wasn't released by the leakers.
Snowden.
WikiLeaks. WikiLeaks or anything else. It was just, it's probably an add-on document that somebody wrote. I can write a document and say Snowden did it. It would be a very stupid act to do on behalf of Israel. I mean, do you think for 1 minute that ISIL is an ally of Israel in any which way?
Why would they
have a guy start an organization that its basis in reality is to destroy you, both Israel and the United States? What would be the point? But it sounds good.
But it is a fact, undeniable fact, that the U.S. government and Israel are helping ISIS.
Really? It's a fact. They're helping, they're providing them with bombs, except they're providing them in a way that they explode when they get them. They send them by air mail, which is F-16s and F-15s and F-whatever they have, and they're sending them bombs. The only problem is the moment they get them, they blow up. So if you call that support, yeah, then they are.
Wait, but if that were the case, wouldn't there be less ISIS troops than like now?
There are. Every day there's less ISIS troops. However, they have a propaganda machine that recruits more and more people to go die. So, you know, you kill them and they get more people. But there's an attrition there, and I'm sure there's less troops now. Nobody really knows how many there are in reality. This is another question that nobody is sure about. The numbers go from 25,000 to 6,000, and nobody is sure.
It's more like 100,000, maybe?
There's no 100,000.
So, where are you, in your own view, Well, what's your view on ISIS exactly? So they're getting much bigger than ever. They want to take out Syria. So they basically...
They're not getting bigger. They're getting smaller now. They're getting reduced by numbers, in big numbers. What is my opinion of ISIS? I mean, I think anybody in a democratic country, in a democratic society, should consider them an enemy. And it's very clear that they are.
So... Okay, so the misconception. So maybe I was wrong in some, and maybe some people who were listening too. So when it comes to the 9/11 and Mossad doing 9/11, which that's most likely wrong in your view, and
no, Mossad didn't do that. Mossad had no connection to it, had nothing to do with it. It's nonsense.
And Mossad helping ISIS, but. In your view, they're
that's
actually decreasing.
That's almost as stupid.
Okay. Okay. What about your perspective? The Mossad and the Paris attacks that happened.
What has that got to do with each other? If they would have had information about those attacks ahead of time, they would have given it to the French. But they didn't. Of course, the French were following these people, and then they decided one day that they're going to stop following them. And then those people struck. I mean, that has been verified because it's been admitted by the French government.
Mm.
How does Mossad tie into that? Why would that be in the interest of the Mossad?
Mm.
Everybody is, the enemies of, you would do something to create an enemy of your, from a friend of, your friend has a friend who's your enemy. You want to make him an enemy of your friend. But if the enemy is already an enemy of your friend and an enemy of yours, you don't need to do anything. Why mm-hmm. would you do anything?
The enemy of my enemy is my friend. I always hear that.
Yes, that's correct. But the enemy of my enemy, but the as you have said before, the U.S. and Israel are allies. So the enemy is already the enemy of my friend. So the enemy of my friend is my enemy.
Oh.
Don't turn it around the other way. It makes no sense. You see, you have to put it in perspective. Everything has to make sense. Things make sense. Okay, in the 1950s, the Israelis had a group of people in Egypt that blew up or tried to blow up some bombs and blame the Egyptian or some underground in Egypt to create a board, you know, to break relationship between the U.S. and Egypt. And it failed and they got caught. But that would make sense because you don't want your enemy, who was Egypt at the time, to be friends with your friend. So you'd like to break it up. But to take an enemy that's already your enemy and your friend's enemy and try to make him what? An enemy? He's an enemy already.
Oh, and that I was thinking of mine in the Camp David Accords with Egypt and Israel, like an agreement.
Yes.
How was that able to be? How did that happen exactly? Because Israel just recognize Palestine?
Because of Sadat, because they were behind the scenes in negotiations, and Sadat agreed that it's time for peace, and he took a brave move. And he came to Israel as a guest of Begin, and they negotiated a peace accord, and they finalized it in Camp David. The same thing happened with Jordan, you know? So that's why.
Oh, so why can't just Israel just recognize Palestine?
That is a question that has a lot of elements to it. There is a perception that says that Israel can't do that because of the water. Because if they recognize Palestine, then they would have to share the water sources with it, and they're limited. That's one perception, which could be true. The other reason, Israel is a right-wing government, which doesn't want to give up territories. There's a messianic movement in Israel. that believes that all the territories belong to Israel. And until such thing happens, there's not going to be peace in the region. So there's no question about that. On that, you have no argument with me. I agree completely that there should be a two-state solution. Or a one-state solution in which Israel annexes the West Bank and the Gaza Strip and puts it into the state of Israel, but then gives all the population, the Palestinian population, full citizenship and let them vote and let them be part of it. Having an occupied territory for so many years is an abomination.
Mm. So so what's your view on the Gaza attacks?
I think it's horrible. I think it's when you have an area that is so small, so heavily populated, Israel keeps claiming that, look at what we did. We gave them their land back, and what did we get in return? Well, that wasn't the case, because Alex Sharon, when he returned the Gaza Strip, he did it against the will of Abbas and everybody else in the Palestinian Authority, who said, please do not leave in one day. Let us, take control and make things regular, and let's get, things organized in a civil manner. And then you pull out in an organized fashion. And when we replace your police with our police, your army with our army, your water system with our water system, and Alex Sharon said no, and he pulled out and left behind a mess. And in that mess, Hamas took over. So, and the Hamas itself was, now there's a place, that's an organization that was basically created by Israel, because Rabin at the time didn't want Arafat to be able to have control by sending money into Israel from Tunisia. And he decided that there should be an internal organization that would get the money, and that way he would cut off Arafat from control. And he allowed the mayors and the clerics that had an organization that was more involved in humanitarian aid, hospitals, schools, that was called Hamas, and he agreed for them to be the ones taking over, and he basically put them in power.
Mm.
So, and that is not a conspiracy. Those are facts.
When it comes, that could be the case, and I'm not... Because like the way you say it, you think of it more like what Mossad should do. Maybe like in your time, maybe when you used to work there. But like, what do you think of recent time? You think
it has nothing to do with Mossad.
Ah,
Mossad is an intelligence service. It should gather intelligence and bring it to the leadership. It shouldn't do anything that it's not told to do.
Ah,
it's not responsible. The CIA is not responsible for policy. The CIA is responsible for gathering information and securing the United States of America and its interests. The same thing as Mossad.
Yeah, but even though the CIA is supposed to be for intelligence...
There's no fight. No. The CIA doesn't do things on its own. The CIA does things that it's asked to do. Now, if it does things on its own... Then you get a committee that comes up and they investigate it and heads roll.
Even though, that is supposed to be the case, but the CIA has done messed up things like killing JF Kennedy.
Absolutely. There's no question organizations mess up.
What?
But that's not the policy. I mean, when you ask me a question, so, if that's a solution for the, in the Gaza Strip and the West Bank, well, why doesn't Mossad? Mossad is not responsible for that. That's not their job.
Hmm. Oh, and so what's your view on JFK being killed? One theory would be that he wanted to inspect Israel's nuclear facility. And
there is a conspiracy like that. And I can't answer it because I don't know that information.
But why doesn't Israel let...
I heard about it, yes.
Why doesn't Israel just let them be inspected, like nuclear facility? Like, why don't they let...
Because they don't want to. Because they don't want to, and they can get away with it.
I thought that even if they don't want to, that would bring some suspicion, though. That's
would bring suspicion. Is that everybody knows Israel has nuclear power. It's already not a veiled piece of information. They don't admit it officially, but they're not a signatory to the London Accord.
London.
So they don't have to show it.
One thing I was in mind
wouldn't
is about.
Wouldn't you want to be the only guy with a gun in the neighborhood? I mean, wouldn't you sleep better if you were the only guy that had a gun in your neighborhood?
I would.
Absolutely. So that's what they want to do. Can't blame them for that. You can blame somebody else for letting them get away with it, but you can't blame them.
I can only hope that that's false though, because killing somebody just because they wanted to inspect it, that would bring suspicion.
Who did they kill somebody that wanted to inspect it?
Okay, because what if that were the case that JFK was a target just because he wanted to keep an eye on what Israel's doing?
You're taking an assumption to a step as if it's fact, and now you're arguing about the fact. We never said that that was the case. I said there is a conspiracy theory that says that. Until that one is proven, there's no point in trying to go on with the argument. It's like trying to swim in a pool that has no water. So you have a pool, but it doesn't mean you can swim until you put water in it. So prove the fact first that that's actually what happened. Then you can figure out why it happened and if it's justified or not.
So what would be your view?
They also say that Kennedy was responsible for the death of Marilyn Monroe. So they say. So what? You know, they say that people didn't go to the moon. And it was all a hoax. You know, if people want to believe that, that's fine. But try to deal with facts.
Okay. What's your view on Gaddafi? Because supposedly they killed him because he was trying to go on the gold standard and something about Africa. He didn't want to go along with his masters. So
Gaddafi was killed because his people revolted against him. He was a dictator, and he tortured people. I mean, who would want to live in a country that Gaddafi is the leader? I mean, would you want to live in a country that Gaddafi was a leader? You know? Why would you want to do that? So his people killed him. Not the gold standard, not anything. There was a revolt. There was an Arab Spring that started in Tunisia and spread.
And
it's well documented.
You know, he was not the best leader, but I wouldn't think it'd be the best thing. Like, he couldn't be the worst guy in the world, necessarily.
He wasn't the worst guy in the world?
I don't think he was. When Israel was, there's this U.S. ship that Israel, killed a bunch of troops.
You're talking about the Liberty?
Yes.
Okay. The Liberty was an accident. Israel admitted attacking it by accident. It was during a war. The ship was in a place that it wasn't notified. The Israeli Navy wasn't notified. And in fact, I spoke to people from the Liberty and I told them that I know the guy and that I know the members of the Navy were involved, and it was an accident. But it doesn't matter. There are still people that will say otherwise, which is fine. And then there was a conversation I had with the U.S. ambassador to Lebanon at the time, and he said that he heard on the radio Israeli pilots identifying the ship as an American ship and still saying attack, attack. So I asked him, how was his Hebrew? And he said, he doesn't speak Hebrew. So I said, why do you think the Israeli pilots will speak English for your benefit?
Hmm.
So there goes that. So theories are theories, and people can talk and say things. Doesn't make it so. And you should know more than all. I mean, you are trying to be media.
I admit I would have to do my research more. I just would hate the, in like it, you say the Mossad wouldn't do it, but I would hate if you were wrong, and like the Rothschilds would.
And I would hate to be wrong too, but I can tell you for a fact that I know the systems and the methods of the organization I work for, and I can tell you for a fact that no person that I know in that organization would agree to be part of anything like 9/11. And I don't care if I like them or dislike them. You have to understand that there are things that people will do and won't do. And I can tell you that every single person that I know in the Mossad, and I knew quite a few, would disobey any order that would call them to do, participate, or do anything of that nature. Whether it was in the U.S., France, Italy, Belgium, Holland, or any one of the American alliance, Israeli alliances. They would refuse the order with no hesitation, regardless of the consequences.
Well, because I would think that, you know, since the Rothschilds are involved in this a lot, they would probably, like, somehow, since the Rothschilds control Israel, they would somehow make that happen.
Wait, stop. What did you just say?
I said
the Rothschilds control Israel?
That's...
Where did you get that from?
Something about Israel being a fiefdom of the Rothschild family.
First of all, the Rothschilds are no longer the richest people in the world. There's a lot richer Jews in the world than the Rothschilds. And Israel is a democracy. It's not a fiefdom. I think it's misguided in its political view as the right wing that it is. But that it's not a fiefdom of anybody. That's ridiculous. Again, I'm sure you saw that on a documentary on YouTube.
Well, this
the Rothschilds have long gone already from the political scene in Israel. In fact, if you go and check it, you'll see that the Rothschilds have a winery in Israel, and they try to get a license to expand it in the territory of Herzliya, and the license was turned down. I don't think that's a fiefdom. So, you know.
But Jacob is still out there. It's like some people from the Rothschilds are still out there. Jacob is still out there.
Absolutely. They're not bad people. Don't forget, they are the ones who made the loans to the U.S. when the U.S. started. And many times during the wars and everything else.
It is very possible that they could help engineer the wars and fund both sides, though. They're very powerful people.
Both sides.
Like let's say World War II. What if the Rothschilds had something to do with the Allies and the Axis?
Wait. You think for 1 minute that the Rothschilds, as Jews, would support in any which way the Nazi regime?
They're not...
I mean, how can you even think that?
No, not Jews as like the Jewish concepts. Jews as in the Zionists. Because for some reason, Zionists represents the Jews. Zionists. Because I've talked to Jews and they're against Zionists, but they're not anti-Semitic.
Yeah, there are Jews that are against Zionism. Absolutely. Because not all Jews are Zionists.
And so Rothschilds are the Zionists, but they're portraying themselves as Jewish.
Wait. Not all Zionists are true Zionists either, because the Zionist dream has been molested by this right-wing government in Israel, which is now claiming more territories and everything else, which I think they should get out of there. I think they should leave the Palestinians in their state and allow them statehood. But from there to go and say that Jews supported the Nazi regime or Zionists or non-Zionists, You're putting out a whole bunch of pieces of information that don't relate to each other. The Zionist movement started in the end of the 1800s and in 1900s and ended in the 20th century. But it's not, it has nothing to do with anything. How does that relate, you know, to the Nazis? Or Rothschilds and the Nazis? And you're confusing a whole bunch of things.
But...
which makes no sense.
But wasn't Hitler put into power by British intelligence?
Oh, come on. Where are you getting your information? I think I should come there and turn down your YouTube and disallow you to look at any more documentaries on YouTube. In fact, I'd probably have to turn off your Facebook, too, and leave you only with Twitter and the New York Times. I'll let you have the Washington Post as well, and you can watch all the networks.
I don't stick to one article, though. I don't stick to Washington Post or the New York Times. You know, most of that, I think it's controlled. You don't think that they would control?
Okay, I'll let you read the Pravda. You can pick any British newspaper you want. Pick up an Italian paper. You know what? You like El Ahara? I'll agree to El Aharam, and I'll agree to El Jazeera. How about that?
I kind of like Al Jazeera. I don't read it much, but...
it's an absolute good network. There's nothing wrong with El Jazeera. It's a little slanted in Arabic, which is expected, but the English version is perfect. It's very balanced. It goes for facts. I would go with you with Al Jazeera. Test everything you say and see if Al Jazeera will put it up.
Wait, so Al Jazeera, I guess, is your favorite one?
No, it's not my favorite one. I like the New York Times.
Oh.
I will accept Al Jazeera as a legitimate network that spews the truth, searches for reality, and checks its facts. Different between various networks. You may have something that's pro-Israeli, so they'll look for stories that they can verify that are pro-Israeli. Somebody's anti-Israeli, they'll look for stories that are anti-Israeli. Both of them are facts. They just have a different way of looking at them, but they can verify what they say. They will never say that Israel's a system of the Rothschilds. They'll never say... but, you know, the Hitler was a British spy?
British intelligence or British secret agent.
First of all, he was a corporal in First World War. He was a failure in anything he did until he met that group of idiots that went with him. And he was a very powerful speaker. And he wasn't a stupid man. He was evil, but he wasn't stupid. So, yeah. But what's the point of the British intelligence creating him? I mean, it's not. Again, your fish are dying. There's no water in your tank.
Because, you know, there's a bunch of stuff that they won't put in the history books. You know that, right?
No, I don't.
Yeah, there's a bunch of things that they won't put in the history books, though. You can't go by the history books. I encourage people to do the research, no matter what.
Well, give me an example and show me how you can research it and prove it. I mean, there are researchers. For example, I'll give you an example. There's a guy who wrote a book, and he did a lot of research. But there were close to 1 million prisoners of war that were German after Second World War. And there were a lot of them in the prisoner... initially, were fed very little and were basically almost 100 of his life. Some people argue with him, but he put out a book. The publisher checked it. They vetted it, because if you put out a book that's with lies in it, you can be sued for libel. Okay? And so they did. It's like somebody said, Okay, here, I'll give you a counter to what you're saying. Somebody came and said that there are Muslim little fiefdoms, if you want to call it that, in London and Paris, where nobody can get in and there's Sharia law in it. And so the mayor of Paris filed a lawsuit against this congressman that spewed this nonsense. There's no such thing. There is no areas in London or Paris that people can't get in. Why do you think there's more active, why are more people joining from Europe ISIS than there are from America? There's a question. You have an answer for that?
I would think it's more easy for them to recruit in Europe than the Middle East, or
why can't they? YouTube and Facebook and Twitter are also in the U.S. Why aren't they recruiting more people from the U.S.?
I guess I'm guessing that they wouldn't want to. They won't want to do anything with the Middle East, or maybe.
No.
I would think it's like if.
There's an answer to that. There's a simple answer to that.
Because of like the Muslim, isn't there like when 9/11 happened, many people thought Muslims did it. So maybe it's the bad relationship.
It has nothing to do with 9/11. It has nothing to do with 9/11.
Muslims were harassed after that.
Just look at the facts. The fact is that in Europe, the young Muslims find it a lot more difficult to integrate into their local society. Those societies, the British are British, the French are French, the Italians are Italians, they're homogenic. It's hard for them to accept foreigners with the foreigners' basic behavior, dress, and whatever. They always look like outsiders, or as the Germans call them, Ausländers. In the U.S. is a country that's built on immigration. Everybody here is an immigrant, either this generation, the one before, or two, or three, or four. So the Muslims in the U.S. find it a lot easier to integrate into the American society. And therefore, they're not as angry as the British Muslims or as the French Muslims. There's no real anti-Muslim feeling here. There's outbursts, you know, when something happens and whatever, and stupid people try to take it out on Muslims. But in general, Muslims they go to universities, they're accepted in society. People that they have friends, their friends don't care if they're Muslim or not. You know, there's doctors and lawyers and teachers and professors, and they integrate into society, and they're a great asset in the U.S. That's why you don't have so many people running from the U.S. to join ISIS. It's because the U.S. is an open society that knows how to deal with their immigrants and give them the space they need to grow.
That makes sense. But how come some people would even get censored in Britain for exposing that ISIS using Facebook? Meanwhile, ISIS is allowed to use Facebook and Twitter, but if you point that out, you would be censored or banned.
No, you're not. You can point it out. In fact, they try to shut down these places that do that, the pages for ISIS. They try, and they manage to do that. But it's an open system. The fact that they're there also makes them visible. You know, when they put things on Facebook, they also can be tracked.
Oh.
You know, so you don't want to shut that down. Let them speak. For the majority of people that see what ISIS is doing, it's not an ad. It's a deficit. I mean, what they did to that Jordanian pilot turn the Muslim world against them, because that is the basis of Muslim. You don't even burn an animal alive. It's against the Muslim religion. People don't understand what Muslim is. It's one of the most peaceful and straightforward religions there are. You know, there's such a misconception about it that it's terrible.
By the way, as from the what I recently said about the Rothschilds controlling Israel, what do you know about the Rothschilds? If you don't think that,
you know,
that would be
very rich family. They're a very rich family. They've made a lot of good stuff. I'm sure they've done over history a lot of bad things. But they're definitely Israel's not one of their systems, and I don't know anything about them.
One guy I most likely. Did he work for Mossad? One guy named Ahmed Merabit, supposedly the French policeman, shot dead. They would move him to Argentina, let's say, for a few months. Is that part of?
Let me tell you this: if I knew a guy in the Mossad and I knew him by his full name, you think I'll actually tell you that?
Oh no, but no, I don't think you would.
No,
but
I would never do that.
But that's what normally would, that's basically what would happen if you would be sent to another country for a few months and change your identity.
That's been done. You send a person to learn his cover in the country that he's supposed to be coming from. Absolutely. You do that. That's part of the routine. Every intelligence agency does that.
So as far as Ahmed Merabit, I don't
know.
I got from this source, Moloco. Dead French policeman is a Mossad agent alive and well in Buenos Aires. Ahmed Merabit, the first French policeman purportedly shot dead, is actually not a Muslim at all. His real name is Avigdor, and his brother's name is Malok. Recently changed to Melek, all of them crypto Jews in the service of Israel intelligence, such as Mossad agents. Avignor is in Buenos Aires right now and will remain there for 6 years, a standing operating procedure with those deep in Israeli psyops. After this, he will refer.
What is this local source that you have?
Smoloco.com.
Slow local?
Smoloco. Smoloko.com.
And this guy is verified this how?
Well, it wouldn't say the source, but since unless there's anything to back it up, I'm just thinking it was a theory.
A theory that makes absolutely no sense. Why would the Mossad have to take somebody and hide him in Buenos Aires? Why not just bring him to Israel?
Yeah, that's what I was thinking. I just wanted to hear your view on that. I didn't believe this one. When I read it. I just thought I should ask it.
You check it by saying, well, would it make sense? Or would it make more sense to bring him to a safe place like Israel? There you go. Got your answer. Unless you think they're stupid. Let's hide him in Buenos Aires. Why? So we need to pay for an apartment in a country we don't have. We need to put people there that protect him. We need to build an identity. We need to do, why? Just bring it to Israel, let him be called a Victor, and forget about it.
There was this prisoner, I don't know if he's free, Mordecai Vanunu, who
worked for the nuclear facility in Israel, and he gave out all the nuclear secrets in Israel. And
18 years in prison.
With photographs and proof of the fact that Israel has a nuclear bomb. Israel hijacked him by taking him from London to Paris, by luring him by a girl. He came to London, and to Paris, he was Italy. And then he was picked up and taken away. And he was brought to Israel, he was tried, he said 25 years of prison, and Israel still won't let him leave the country.
How long is he going to be in prison for?
He's now a Christian. He changed religion to Christian. He's supported by a group from Australia that are making every effort to bring him. But there you go. That's it.
So he's free now? Or he's still in jail for like another year?
He's free in Israel, but he's not free to meet with reporters, and he's not free to go out of the country.
When can they let him out of the country?
It's not clear.
So you're saying that he's still stuck in the country, he can't leave or talk to anyone, and a group in Australia wants to...
Talk to everybody, but he can't talk to reporters, and he can't leave the country.
Oh, that sucks. So
I know it, but you know, it is what it is. And the reason they're giving is that he knows secrets about the nuclear facilities that he could then expose. And everybody's saying, well, he was in jail because he exposed what he knew. So it's not a secret anymore. So the Supreme Court of Israel said the fact that people know about a secret and know the information in a secret doesn't stop it from being a secret.
I thought maybe some people would consider him a hero in a way, like Snowden.
Absolutely, yes, some people do.
What do you think? That he was a bad guy, right?
I think he did the right thing.
Really?
Absolutely.
Why do you say that? I thought you would think he's a bad guy or something.
That's my opinion. I don't think that Israel should have a nuclear power. Should be a nuclear power. I think that it gives it arrogance in dealing with its neighbors that is continuing the peace, avoiding the peace process.
I thought, like, if Israel...
It's causing everybody else in the neighborhood to want to build a bomb. If Israel stopped building their bombs and defused that thing, Iran would have no excuse to build one.
Well, now Iran has one.
Iran does not have one.
Iran does not have a nuke?
No, they don't.
Wait, why can't they have a nuke exactly? Do they know they don't know how to make one, or they just don't have the...
No, they haven't reached that point yet. It takes development on a certain level. They're heading in that way. They're what's called a virgin country. They will have a bomb in a certain period of time, but they're willing to negotiate against it.
I thought that Putin would help Iran make a bomb, a nuke.
Who would help?
Putin would help, or what? Russia in general would help Iran make it. That's what I thought.
No, they're in the problem. They don't need it. You have scientists in Iran that are brilliant. The Iranian people are not a group of a bunch of farmers. They're a very advanced society with a very, you know, I mean, here's an example of involvement U.S. involvement that causes what Iran had a democratic elected government. And then the CIA toppled it and brought the Shah into power. And that's a fact.
Yes.
And the Shah was a brutal dictator, which brought about the Ayatollah Khomeini. And that's a fact.
Yes.
So, and then the U.S. supported Iraq in its war against Iran, which caused even more animosity between the two countries. Actually, Iran should be the biggest ally of the U.S. because they're Shia, and most of the enemies of the U.S. today, which are ISIS and Al-Qaeda, are Sunni.
And they're fighting ISIS.
Iran as well.
But what about Israel? The U.S. having like 42 bases surrounding Iran? I don't think they should have 42 bases surrounding Iran.
What difference?
Because they always call Iran as a threat.
No. That's ridiculous. Who cares how many bases?
Yeah, but they always say Iran is a threat.
What difference does it make?
No, the U.S. always calls Iran a threat. Yeah, we have bases surrounding them.
Well, they are a threat. They're calling the U.S. the big devil.
But how does that make them more of a threat? It's like saying it's like saying I'm calling someone a devil, but yet you're surrounding me.
Right.
What?
The enemy of my enemy is my friend.
Yeah, I know. But what does that have?
And Al Qaeda are enemies of Iran. That would make Iran a friend of the U.S.
But
logic.
But you wouldn't have. Why would you need to surround a country 42 bases? Aren't
Why
you the
not?
Threat? Because isn't the U.S.
Why
a threat
not?
if you surround Iran?
First of all, I don't know that they have 42 bases surrounding Iran.
Each.
But if they do, that's fine. Are they attacking Iran from those bases?
Yep, but one thing, but one thing that it could be probable is that since we're funding ISIS to support to overthrow the Syrian government of Bashar, we're gonna go right to Iran right afterwards.
No, you're not. That's not true.
I mean, I didn't say it's gonna happen, but like it's part of an agenda.
There's a gap in there, and that's where ISIS came in. The lack of support allowed ISIS to get in, not support for ISIS.
So exactly why you said Iran should be like the best friend of the U.S.
I didn't say the best. I said a friend.
So why isn't Iran a friend of the U.S. now?
Because it's not. I said it should be.
I wish it were. I don't think Iran. I've never been to Iran, but like Iran hasn't done anything to me. So why would I want to go to war? Why would I want to go to war against it? And I certainly wouldn't put bases around it.
Then you're going to war. Why are you going to war? You're negotiating now.
Oh, yeah. That,
negotiating.
Oh, that article, you told me to tell which article I found that. Experts, Iran now a nuclear-ready state, missiles capable of hitting the U.S.
But
one's from the Jerusalem Post. The role of Israeli leaders to adopt the policies to protect Israel.
There's your propaganda. The Jerusalem Post is saying that they're not saying they have a bomb. If you read the article, they're saying they're close to and within...
Intercontinental ballistic missile, ICBMs, basically.
And they have built ICBMs to deliver them, because everybody's saying, well, if they have a bomb, how are they going to deliver them? So you're saying that Iran is going to... And this is the stupid part in the Jerusalem Post, because if Iran fires a missile... at Israel, it's going to kill a hell of a lot of Palestinians in the West Bank and in Gaza. You can't say on one hand Israel's this tiny country.
I'm not saying
needs help, and on the other hand say it's a big enough country that you can fire a missile at Israel and not hit Palestinians. Which debunks this idea that Iran wants to bomb Israel with a nuclear bomb.
I didn't say they would do that, but I'm saying, is Iran capable of making a nuke? And I don't think Iran's an enemy.
Sure,
I don't think Iran's an enemy, though. But yet, to the U.S., some people in Washington are probably thinking of how to invade Iran.
But we're not arguing. We're saying the same thing. You're just saying it in a different tone.
Saying different tone, but arguing the same thing?
Yeah, you're saying why should Iran be an enemy of the U.S.? And I'm saying it's not an enemy of the U.S. I think it's threatened the U.S. It's made overtures to the U.S., but it's not a threat. I don't think Iran is a threat.
I think
the threat to the U.S. is not making a deal with Iran. And I think that is in the best interest of the right-wing government in Israel that is trying to sabotage the deal that the President of the United States is trying to work out.
But wouldn't you technically be a threat if you are surrounding a country with army forces? Because at any minute, what if the U.S. soldiers were told to invade Iran? You don't think that's illegal international law? To invade a country that has... That's what I was thinking, because what if they were given order, all these army bases surrounding Iran, to just invade Iran? Indo-Iran has done absolutely nothing. That's wrong.
What if the U.S. Army that's based around on the border with Mexico was given an order to invade Mexico? I mean, you're making an argument that is not there.
I hope that doesn't happen, though.
That's... No, it won't happen. It's not supposed to happen. The U.S. is not going to war with Iran, so let's change subject.
Because I always thought it's an agenda. Because, Russia's helping Syria to get, fight ISIS. But ISIS has like half of Syria. So after they're done with Syria, they're going to go right after Iran. It's part of an agenda.
You're doing conjecture of things that don't match.
Things that don't match.
You're conjecturing, and you have no basis for your conjecture.
I guess there could be theories, maybe, in a way, But it's not like it's a stupid. Like, it could happen. You know, people are freaking crazy in the government and a bunch of places around the world. People are crazy enough to do that.
Of course, there are people crazy, and there are people crazy that are in power. But that doesn't mean things happen. So, you know,
just one thing to keep in mind. But this is one thing I had a question. This statement: we're going to take out 7 countries in 5 years. This was from the U.S., from some people in the U.S. government. We're going to take out 7 countries in 5 years. Iraq, Syria.
Wait, who said that?
General Wesley Clark. Quote.
General Wesley Clark said we're going to take out 7 countries in...
This is from globalresearch.ca.
What?
This is from Global Research, the article. We're going to take out 7 countries in 5 years. Iraq, Syria, Lebanon, Libya, Somalia...
Clark said, and I read his book, and General Clark would never say something like that. So I don't buy that story.
You say you read the book, but like that doesn't mean he won't be like that in person. That's like saying me writing good things in a book about myself. But deep down, if you talk to a guy, you know, off camera, etc.
Let me tell you something. Deep down, some people have fetishes. So what does that mean? Deep down. The government is not run by deep down. Armies don't move for deep down. You have a lot of people in militaries around the world that are sadists. And they enjoy war. But that doesn't mean they go to war.
So the war in Iraq is justifiable? Is that in general?
Wait. Stop for a second. You're talking to me about philosophy. This is not my strong suit, and I don't think I can answer any more questions. That would be, what if somebody said that, if somebody else said that, and deep down inside he thought that, and he didn't say it, but he could mean it, and what if he actually thought about it? That's like going way out there. That's like revisiting the moon. So let's go back to facts.
I'm just saying that it wasn't justified to, you know, to invade Iraq. You know, Iraq hasn't attacked us.
That's what you say. Wait a minute. I agree with you that it was a stupid move. But there was justification. The justification wasn't the oil. The justification wasn't the weapons of mass destruction that he didn't have. The justification should have been that he's a terrible dictator that is threatening the countries around him. He already invaded one country. He's trying to get weapons of mass destruction. He's a threat, a real and live danger to the U.S., and therefore we should invade. I agree that was a wrong decision.
What about Afghanistan?
Afghanistan was the... I think they should have gone into Afghanistan with special forces and just taken out Al-Qaeda.
Yeah, but what about us funding the people who are fighting? Hillary Clinton said this 30 years ago. The people were fighting 30 years ago. We funded.
Yeah, you funded. You funded the Mujahideen when they were fighting the Russians. That was a clear and present threat to the U.S. The Russians were the Soviets. So you funded them, and you created the people you're fighting now. No question about that.
So didn't Al Qaeda change its name just to confuse people to ISIS, and then we end up funding the people who defect to ISIS, Al Qaeda, because like it's over 90%.
No. Now you're going again. Don't. Well, you can, you know, but not with me on the air.
So that's not your strongest point, but like if you didn't know much about it, I wouldn't mind your opinion on it.
Well, my opinion, I told you my opinion.
So it means it can, but that doesn't mean it will, or you just don't know about it, which is okay, you know. But it's just something I just want to bring up to.
Sure.
So it is a fact that the U.S. government is being taken over by evil people who are like having it, like.
That's not a fact.
So what's your view on that?
I think that's not a fact, and therefore I can't comment on something that's not a fact.
So why is the U.S. government doing this crazy stuff?
Like, taken over by evil people, I would be against it. That's an opinion. The fact that they are being taken over, that's not a fact.
So why would the U.S. government like try to destroy America deliberately?
The American government is trying to destroy. Again, it's not a fact. This is a conjecture that has no basis in reality.
So you think the Rothschilds don't have an influence in the U.S. government?
Now we're back in the Rothschilds. Anybody who has money has influence on politicians. Absolutely. Who are the politicians that are influenced? I don't know. But right-wing Republicans donate money and they influence politicians. Left-wing guys donate money and they influence politicians. Money influences politicians because they need money to get elected. Absolutely. That's a fact. There's no argument about it.
So, because...
But to say that the Rothschilds, that you know the Rothschilds' agenda... and who they're actually trying to fund, that is not a fact.
So you're saying that people in the U.S. government are doing this stuff on purpose, trying to get us into wars. They're doing that deliberately.
Who said that? I don't put words in my mouth. I never said that.
No. Well, if you're saying nothing is taking over the U.S., the Rothschilds probably would have an influence, but it doesn't mean they're taking over the country. So that means people in the government will deliberately try to wreck their country? I don't think...
Who said that?
No, I didn't say you did, but like, I'm thinking if nobody's taking over the U.S.
You're thinking. Well, listen, don't put words in my mouth. I never said that.
Okay.
And I disagree with that notion.
So you're saying basically the Rothschilds just have a high influence in the U.S.?
No, I didn't say that either. I said all people with money, and the Rothschilds definitely have money,
definitely.
If they want to have an influence in politics, they can. I didn't say they wanted one way or another. I didn't say if they were pro or against. I didn't say that they were investing money in politics at all. I don't even know if they care. I'm just saying people with money have influence. That's not a conjecture. That's a fact. If you had money, you could influence politics.
Yeah, but what about all the decisions of, you know, who gets to be president? Because, you know, the people don't call the shots. There are powerful people that call the shots in the country.
On a free democratic vote that is carried out once every 4 years in the United States. And that's what happens. It's carried out and it's vetted and it's checked and it's double checked. And until you can prove it differently, that's the way things work. So, you know,
But we shouldn't deny that powerful people are taking over the government. You know, like let's say the Federal Reserve.
They're influencing the government.
Yeah. So the government's just, you know,
absolutely.
They're being...
How do you know they're not influencing them for good things? The guy from Microsoft is influencing the government, and he does, to help and support people. You know?
Yeah, but...
is influencing politics for the good things. So,
Yeah, but isn't reality saying otherwise? You know, economic crisis, so...
No, I don't know what reality you are living in. It doesn't. It's the most powerful country in the world, the most successful. Its economy is the best in the world. The living standards here are better than anywhere else. Why exactly do you... Where's the evil here? Where is the evil?
I would start by saying whatever, like, let's just say what would the like what the federal government is doing as far as, you know, militarizing the police, spying on its own citizens.
No, they're not military. What they're doing is they're providing the police with protection and equipment that appear to be militarizing. Because they're military operations. Because when you have a gang in Boston or in New York or in Chicago, you don't go and fight them with pistols while they outgun the police. You remember that group that shot, with, what is it, New York or Chicago? And the police were completely outnumbered and outgunned. And they made a massacre there of the police. Is that what you want? So sure, so the police, the more you can buy guns in the U.S., so you have gangsters with machine guns, and you want the guy to have a poppy gun? Of course you want to arm them. You want to protect the population, but you have people that say, oh, look, they're dressed in black, so therefore they're bad people. You could say that about Muslims. They're dressed in black, too.
Yeah, it's but... ridiculous. Yeah, that itself is ridiculous. I agree that... But I don't believe you should militarize the police, because, you know, this is not the war zone. This is not Afghanistan. This is not...
You want the SWAT team to go in with protection?
Yeah, but they shouldn't give every single police force, like, as if it's war here.
What are they going to take you over? Did they take you over anywhere? What are you talking about?
Because this is one of the signs that there could be martial law if it keeps up. You don't think that martial law could go from just militarizing the police?
No. Because the police are citizens too. And they don't want to be under martial law. You're forgetting who you're dealing with. These are good people that are, you know, that are going out there and risking their life every day to protect the citizenry. And you're trying to make them evil because they wear a helmet so nobody will blow their head off. I don't see the logic in that. Now, if you came and told me that you're going to take everybody's guns away and make this country without guns, that every second person has a machine gun or whatever, then I'd agree with you. Then we'd say it's like, you know, you don't need it.
I don't want to take anybody's guns away.
If you can go out and buy an M16 and buy whatever kind of weaponry you want and hoard it and create a little militia that can go and attack the police, then I want the police to be able to fight back because they're protecting me.
But I didn't say I want to take anybody's guns away though. I didn't want people to have guns. I believe in the Second Amendment. I'm pro-gun.
Well, don't you? Second Amendment. Okay, don't forget. Everybody thinks that's the law. Don't forget that's an amendment. That's just my opinion. I'm allowed to have that opinion.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Yeah, no doubt.
And I think you're allowed to have a gun. Because that's the law.
Wait, isn't it true that in Israel it's required to have a gun?
No.
No?
You're not required to have a gun. They give you a gun when you're in the army, and then when you leave, you give it back.
Oh, in Switzerland, everybody would have guns pretty much, and everybody's required to be in the
army. No, you don't. Very hard to get a license for a gun in Israel.
No, I didn't say Israel, I said Switzerland. Everybody has guns over there.
Well, because they're a militia, everybody's part of the army. And they stay part of the army. They serve for, you know, 18 months, I think. And then they go home with their weapons. And if they're called up, they come back with their guns. That didn't happen for a lot of time.
I wish the U.S., like, everybody would, you know, everybody would have guns. I think the U.S. could learn a lot from Switzerland, though.
Now we're talking about subjects I have no idea about.
That's just my opinion. You know.
Well, there you go. You're allowed.
But okay. Besides, you know, your career in being part of Mossad. After that, you're now an artist, right? Painter.
Yes.
Okay. Can you talk about that?
I always been an artist. I've been an artist since I was a kid.
Oh.
And I painted, and I paint now, and I sell in a gallery in Scottsdale, and I sell in a gallery in Laguna Beach, and I sell in a gallery in Irvine Spectrum, and I sell in a gallery in Edmonton, Alberta, and I sell a gallery in New York. And that's what I do. I do that, and I do the book patch.
Well, and there's all kinds of artwork, which is amazing, really. Whether it's abstracts, bar, biblical, books, streets, vehicles.
Yeah, I do a lot of art.
Wow.
Well, thank you.
No problem. So you were an artist like pretty much all your life, right?
That's correct. I've been painting since I was 5.
Were your parents artists?
No.
How did you get into art?
I just started when I was 5. I enjoyed it.
Nice. What I wanted to ask earlier is about the Federal Reserve printing fiat money, and
I have no idea about that. Don't ask me about the Federal Reserve. I have no knowledge of what they do, how they do it, no understanding of it. So I can't answer that. I mean, I'll sound like one of your YouTube things.
Well, I don't know if you know about Serial Girl, or you don't know about her either.
No.
Ah. Oh, so.
Getting harder and harder, right?
I thought you were only a Mossad agent and a painter. That's pretty much just those two things you've done with your life, I guess.
Well, no. I wrote books. I wrote 5 books, and they were published, and they were bestsellers. And I now have a company called thebookpatch.com where anybody can go in and write a book and upload it and create a cover for it and order a single copy for less than $5.
Ah.
And it's called thebookpatch.com where books grow, you know, in a book patch.
Oh, I see it.
Yeah, there you go. And we have over 50,000 authors that are writing books and publishing with us.
Oh, so basically that's your upcoming projects, or if you have any?
It's working now. It's online right now as we speak.
Oh, you run the site?
The site is up and running for already 5 years.
Oh. Oh, I didn't know you created the site. I thought you were just showing me like a link to somebody else's.
No, it's my site.
Oh, wow, that is awesome. Ah, nice. Victor, before you go, what's your message you would like to say to anybody who's listening? Because, like, you're one of the first and only Mossad agents and painters that I've ever had on.
I wanted to know that I know for a fact that they should keep listening to your station. Because from now on, your research will be very thorough. And you're not going to spew out things that are just conjecture and you think about it. Because I'm sure you want to be a good reporter and report the truth. So
definitely.
This is one. Second thing, I think that even when they believe you, they should still double check it.
Of course. I encourage people to question what I say.
Number three, I don't think that they should look at YouTube as a basis for information. That is an entertainment center. And I think that they should not learn their news from the late night show or from, all these talk shows, but actually listen to the news, whether it's Al Jazeera or CBS or NBC or CNN, and understand that those people are involved in vetting and checking and doing things and still don't take it for their word because they make mistakes too.
The reason I just wouldn't trust the news so much because like it's the corporate media, you know, 6 corporations run 90% of what you watch.
Yes.
And CBS have to do with the Rockefellers and there was a CBS president and that actually made deals with the CIA.
Why are you keep bringing up all the rich Jews?
How about the rich Saudis? How about the rich Russians? How about the rich French? They have agendas.
I haven't looked into those. But I just look into I just looked into the Rothschilds very recently. I haven't looked into those, but I will.
I know you will.
But if the Rothschilds are Zionists, why would Zionists be Jews?
Who said the Rothschilds are Zionists?
No, because you said Rothschilds were Jews. Every time I say Rothschilds, you're saying I'm talking about Jews. I don't think they should be considered Jews necessarily. I had recently Rabbi Weiss. And he doesn't like the Zionists, and he's Jewish. He's a rabbi.
Yeah, not every Jew is a Zionist.
And the Zionists technically are the New World Order, though.
And by the way, not every Zionist is a Jew. So,
but the Zionists aren't the New World Order, technically are. Right?
The new what?
The New World Order.
No, they're not. They're the Zionists. They're the Zionist movement. It's a movement to create the state of Israel. And Orthodox Jews don't agree with them. And a whole lot of others don't agree with them. So what? It doesn't make anything.
Well, I thought that the Zionists technically are the ones in the New World Order.
When you say, I thought, don't say, this is my opinion, or I have proof for this. You know, what you thought is already saying that you're not sure about it, and it's something that you may change your mind about because you thought it, and now you can think something else.
Well, okay, that's my opinion, that the Zionists aren't the New World Order in some way.
Well, I have no basis for that, and I think your opinion is misguided. And that's my opinion.
So as far as the New World Order is, you don't know much about it, do you?
What?
Do you know much about the New World Order? Or you're just not into it?
No, I know the New World Order is a myth that has been brought up again and again, which actually means nothing. Because there is no order in this world. Look at it. Where's the order? It's a mess. Look at Russia. Look at the Ukraine. Look at Syria. Look at Iraq. Look at the economy that toppled. Where's the world order? Where's the order?
Not order as in like everything stable. New World Order as in what countries should follow. According to George H.W. Bush, he said
a new world order, a rule in which
the rule of law governs the conduct of nations.
No, that's
his quote.
The Germans wanted to create a new world order. They couldn't. Nobody can put this world in order or create an order that everybody will follow. There's no such thing. It can't be done. As much as you'll try, it can't be done.
Well,
everybody has an opinion. Everybody has something he wants. So forget about it. But you don't have to. Last question.
Oh. All right. So what do you want to tell all the listeners out here besides just questioning and? You know, everybody should always research it, and you're an artist yourself, and go check out the site.
Yeah, I think people should read books, and I think people should enjoy reading, and I think people should lighten up. The world is not such a bad place after all.
Of course, and there are a bunch of people that are good in every faction. There's people that are good in the Mossad, like you. There's good people in the CIA. There's good people in everywhere.
Absolutely. And there's bad people everywhere.
Oh, yeah. That's what we got to watch out for.
Absolutely. No question about that. You got good cops, you got bad cops. You got good citizens, bad citizens. Good African-Americans, bad African-Americans. Good white people, bad white people.
So, you know, what are your thoughts on 2015 and beyond?
The what?
On the year 2015, this year, and beyond.
Yes.
What are your thoughts on it?
I think it's going to be a mess.
A mess?
Just like 14, 13, 12, 11, 10, 9, 8, 7, and so on and so forth.
I think that big stuff is going to happen. Like, that's just my opinion.
It always does. Okay, man.
I saw a few false flags in mind that I'm thinking of. Well, or it's more trying to get more into war with Russia and Ukraine. I think that's going to be, and ISIS and Syria is going to be capitalizing more.
We'll find out as time passes. I mean, that's the advantage of time. You learn more. It was great talking
Definitely.
To you.
Oh, same. Thank you for being on the show, Victor.
Not a problem at all. Talk to you later.
Later.
Have a good time.
Thank you. You too.
Bye-bye.
Bye. You've heard it here, folks. Wow. So, everybody has their own opinions. I respect that. And it's okay if you don't know about certain things, but it's important to acknowledge them and back yourself up at the same time, you know, and but never stop asking questions. Don't believe the official story. Have your own conscience. Have common sense. You know, truth is in a democracy, and truth is stranger than fiction. You know? So we have to realize that, everybody, and come together if we want this country and this planet back. Jeez. Seriously now.